And I'm saying these words on purpose. Rich, wealthy, successful. All of these, God has given you the power to be. Rich, wealthy, successful. The Common English Bible says he's the one who gives you the strength to be prosperous. Rich, wealthy, successful, prosperous. Now, I'm stressing that. Now, thank the Lord. Some of you all didn't have to go through the channels I had to go through with some of this. But maybe those in television, some folks, I just still get a little bit bent out of shape by saying these words. Now, don't get mad at the messenger. You want to get mad at God. We're reading it there. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that's given you this power to get wealth. So Common English Bible says he's the one who gives you the strength to be prosperous in order to establish the covenant he made with your ancestors, and that's how things stand right now. Now, last week we also established who were our ancestors. Genesis 12, 1 and 3, and I'm going to move really, really fast so I can get to where I need to get to. Genesis 12, chapter verse 1 through 3 says, now the Lord said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. I will bless them that bless thee and curse them that curses thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So now we begin this story with Abraham. He's our ancestor. God promised him these blessings. Now, what else some blessings he made? Like I said, I'm going to move very fast, so don't worry about going to it. Just take notes on it. Genesis 13, 14, and 17. And the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up thou now thine eyes, look from the place where thou art, north, south, east, and west, for all the land which thou see, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. And I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, so that if a man can number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed also be numbered. Arise, walk through the land, in the land of it, and the breath of it, for I will give it unto thee. Now, what else did this covenant he made with our ancestors? Genesis 17, 6 through 8. And I will make thee exceeding fruitful. I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee, in their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee, and I will give unto thee and to thy seed after thee the land wherein thou art a stranger, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. So now, once again, I meant to leave it at Genesis 8:18. Just flow with me. Don't go ahead of me. I've been doing this 30 years. Just follow the leader. Genesis 8, Deuteronomy, rather, 8:18. If thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth, we gave you all the translation, that he may establish his covenant. Now, we read the covenant that he made to Abraham, unto swear unto thy fathers, it is this day. That covenant was to just bless you, bless you, bless you, bless you, and bless you. In other words, everything that God promised Abraham, you are entitled to that. I told him in the first service, if you really, really want to know what you're entitled to, just study the life of Abraham. Study all that Abraham had. You don't even have to really, I mean, of course you stay with the Bible, but read the history of Abraham. See, this is not something that's made up. These are historical facts that Abraham, he basically owned half of the county. See, that's why nobody was going to call him crazy when the Lord told him to change your name from Abram to Abraham and go around saying you father many and you don't have any. They were scared because they all worked for him. So now, all of these promises are not only to Abraham, but to his seed forever. Now, who is his seed? Let's go to Galatians 3. Galatians, the third chapter of Galatians, and I'm just going to save time. And let's go to just verse 29. Third chapter of Galatians, verse 29. If you can put that on screen, that would be wonderful. Third chapter of Galatians, verse 29. If you be Christ, now that's us, those of us who are born again, then are you Abraham's seed? Now, you don't have to know the Greek. You don't have to have went to seminary to pretty much understand this. And if you be Christ, we are in Christ, those of us who are born again, then you are Abraham's seed. Now, all those verses I read that God said, I promise to bless you and your seed, you and your seed, you and your seed. You're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise that we just read. Amen. You are an heir to the promises that God gave Abraham. Blessed to be a blessing. Blessed till all families of the earth. Just blessed. And the Bible gives a description of the wealth of Abraham. It says he was very rich in silver and gold. Now we can translate that very rich in cash and stocks and bonds. It says he had cattle. Now we can translate that as far as businesses. Now, I'm really nailing this on purpose because I know it's going to take time for many of us to renew our minds with this. Because I know most of us, you know, I ain't coming against your parent or nothing. They couldn't leave anything. They didn't have anything. And they can't do what they didn't know. And with some of you, you know, your parent, if they went on, they may have left you, you know, a jar. This is my mama's favorite dress. Praise the Lord. Amen. Wonderful. I ain't coming again. It's something better than nothing. And then sad, some left them with some bills. You know. But that's all right. We ain't holding nothing against anybody. Come on now, we ain't holding anything against anybody. Now, let me say this before somebody says, I'm still mad at my daddy for not leaving. Well, if you got kids, if something happened to you today, are you leaving them something? Something they can live off? That's another message for another time. See, I felt that. Somebody kind of threw that. Well, I didn't leave me. Well, okay. Do you got something to leave? Not your favorite dress. Or, sir, your raggedy car. But all of that's not the point. We are heirs to a covenant of wealth. Now, we just got to figure out how to get it. Well, we don't have to figure out. The word tells us how to get it. But see, you got to first get that in. I'm an heir. I'm all that stuff, Abraham. And it's not gone. It's still in the earth. There's no shortage of land. There's no shortage of property. Now remember, Abraham looked from north, south, east, and west. Don't limit yourself to the city you're in. I'm trying to help somebody with that. You are heirs to that. We have been living beneath our privilege because we didn't know it. See, you got to take this on just like as if you found out that was $100 million, wouldn't you be upset if that was $100 million in one of your closets and been there since you've been at the place you're in, and here you are struggling with your gas off and lights off. Just been struggling and you know, your hat and got gray and fell out and everything else because you didn't worry about this and that. And all along, $100 million has been in the closet. That'll make you like, what? All this time I've been and borrowing money and getting embarrassed and all of this and that, and it's been here all along. This is the same thing here. See, because once you get this, then you're going to take on a different mindset. You're going to have a different perception about things. See, when you get this to your fullest, then you're not thinking about, I got to buy something, because it's already yours. See, and I know this is going to take time. It's going to take some time. And that's why I keep reading it over and over and over and over again. All that was promised to Abraham, if we're in Christ, we are his seed. See, because the promise God made to Abraham, without getting into that whole third chapter of Galatians, it wasn't just to his biological seed. One translation says the seed of the anointed one, to Jesus, the Christ to come. And we are in Christ. And we're heirs to that promise. To that promise. See, it's bigger than just the stuff. If Abraham just had this stuff, like in the natural, you know, if I have a car and I leave my car to my children, that's it. It ain't just about the stuff. We're heirs to the promise. See, that's bigger than the stuff. Somebody missing that? See, it's just like if the Lord made a promise to me that he promised me he was going to give me $100 million. And that promise is also to my seed. It's not about my seed having the $100 million, but the promise is the seed will also have that. See, it's not just about Abraham's stuff. We're heirs to the promise. That I will bless you. I will make your name great. See, in other words, making your name great, it's not just about fame, but great. In other words, folks will talk good things about you. Make your name great. Hallelujah. But if you be in Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Oh, my. See, so get that in your system. We have a covenant of wealth by way of through Abraham, the promise that was given to him. And since we're in Christ, we're heirs to that promise. See, so what that should get in you right then, like, I need to find out how I can get this promise now. Because this belongs to me. I'm not supposed to be struggling about anything any longer. Now, one of the first keys in putting yourself in position to receive this covenant is in the first division that we started last week. And we kind of gave the first division of that teaching called the perfect picture of prosperity. Now, let's go to 3 John, because prosperity is connected to your covenant of wealth. 3 John 1 and 2. says, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers." That you prosper and be in health. I kind of like to say health and wealth. So not only are you to be wealthy, you're supposed to be healthy. Hallelujah. Healthy and wealthy. Tell somebody, I'm supposed to be healthy and wealthy. Tell them again, I'm supposed to be healthy and wealthy. Now, there are no restrictions here. You know, it don't say based on your age. See, I got to throw that out because, you know, believe it or not, when I got this revelation of especially living strong for 120 years, some years ago, and of course you'll get flack on, and some people say, well, you know what? Because probably at the time I was probably in my late 30s. They say, you just wait. See, you saying that now because you're in your 30s. You just wait till you get 40. All right, I got 40. Amen. And we're still saying it. Yeah. Well, you just keep waiting till you want to, then just kept getting into my 40s. Amen. Then when I turned 47, I gave myself a membership to the health club. Amen. And then some of the same said, all right, just wait. Then I turned 50. You just wait. Well, then at 51, I got my card membership that I could enter a bodybuilding show at 51. So now, yeah. I don't know what's going to happen when we get 60. Tell somebody I'm supposed to be healthy and wealthy. So now, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospers. Now, first of all, this lets me know that where prosperity begins. Prosperity begins in your soul. In other words, the determining factor or the key to any level of prosperity in your life is based on your mindset. It's based on your perception. It's based on your beliefs. It's based on how you think. Why? Because you'll never go beyond how you think. And I've taught for years, before you get to that next level, what? You're going to have to think on that next level. Because you can't go beyond where your mindset is. Proverbs 23:7, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he." That's a biblical law. And I found out really that one of the main reasons that can separate the prosperous person from the poverty person is not the money. It's not even the opportunity. It's the mindset. Successful people have a different mindset than unsuccessful people. Different mindset. See, now some folks think, well, if I got this opportunity. No, it ain't about the opportunity. Because when your mind is right, you'll create the opportunity. Or you'll even be able to see the opportunity when they come. Because opportunities come around us more often than we would think. But because of our perception, we're never able to see it. I was told years ago, At least $1 million is waiting to be made by you just within a few blocks of where you at. So the opportunities be there. But if your mind is not there, you can't see it. So now, for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. So now, the decisions you make in life is based on really what's been programmed in your mind. And that's with all of us. You know, what's in your believing system? In other words, when you think a certain way, you're going to act a certain way. You know, how you perceive things. See, we all have different perception about things. You know, somebody, I can hold this up and somebody say, what color is it? Somebody could say black. Somebody might could say charcoal. Somebody might say dark. So we necessarily don't all have the same perception. You know, somebody can look at one person and say, oh, they fat. And somebody say, no, they just big. Or look at somebody and say, man, they are bony. No, they say, no, they ain't. They just kind of thin. Amen. See, we all have a different perception. Amen. Your belief directly affects how you perceive things. And we all know your perception becomes your reality. Whatever you perceive, that's real to you. Now, whether it's true or not, if you perceive it a certain way, it's real to you. Yeah. See, if I perceive that she don't like me, if that's my perception, and it may not even be true, but it's real to me. Because your perception is your reality. So now, scripture says, you may prosper and be in health, even or according to how your soul prospers, your mindset. Now, this word prosper, it means to succeed or to thrive or success or favorable. But I was doing a little research on yesterday, and it says this word prosper, as your soul prospers, in the original Greek, it literally means to grant a prosperous and expeditious journey. This word prosper means to lead by a direct and easy way, which kind of lets me know it's not supposed to be difficult. And expeditiously, somewhat quickly. It also means to cause to prosper. So prosper according to as my soul prospers, or to grant a prosperous journey, to lead or to cause to prosper. So what this is basically saying is it takes the soul to lead you on the journey to prosperity. Your mindset. And I asked this question in the first service, that could it be the reason some of our lives are not prospering is because our mind has not led us there. Amen. See, you can't go to a place where your mind has never been. Amen. See, if your mind is not there, you can't go there. Amen. So in other words, there's no way you can get on the prosperous journey and you don't have a prosperous mind. And really, and that's even as pastoring, how sometimes that can be frustrating to try to take, thank God not this group, but to try to take people to a certain level and their mind is not there. You know. And Lord had to check me with that even some time ago. Sometimes you expect people to be at a certain level in a certain place, and they can't be there because their mind not there. You know, it's kind of like, don't you know how to sweep the floor? But if your mindset is not there, you don't. See, things in life are not automatic. See, your mind got to be there, because see, you can't go where what's not here. Amen. You can't walk the love walk if you don't mind have a mindset of love. There's no way you can be somebody's good spouse if you don't have a mindset of what it is to be a good spouse. I'll go deeper. And God, and it's a shame it's this way. That's the reason you don't have good parents. Because they don't know how. Now, I know you had the kids. That was the easy part. And you couldn't go. You can raise a kid to a certain level because you didn't have it. Can't go in life where your head is not. Now, I ain't coming against you. That's just the truth. Oh, my. See, I can't lead you to a better life if your mind refuses to cooperate. You know, because you can't go beyond your thinker. Like I said before you get to that next level in life, you're going to have to think of them. It's going to have to really be there. See, that's sometimes why we try things. I mentioned earlier about there's no reward in starting. Amen. See, we try stuff, but if it's not here, you're not going to complete it. That's why you have a lot of folks start things, a lot of folks with 1,001 ideas. This is what we used to call a jack of all trades, but master of none. Never completed anything. Because the mind was never there to do it. Amen. You tried. But if that mind was there, your life was, it was not going to go there. You couldn't go on that journey. Amen. So you see, your beliefs, your perception, how you think leads you to the journey. You can't go on the prosperous journey if a prosperous mind is not leading you. See, you can't go on a million-dollar journey with a $5 mindset. I don't care how much you want the $1 million. I don't care how much you want the good wife or the great husband or the good job or the great career or the degrees. See, we can really say, and it's just the truth, and man, I understand there are other things that affected us too, but see, our journey is based on where our head is. And that's not nothing against you, because you can't do what you don't know. That's why I say, if what's in us, we act a certain way, and that's how we always respond. Let's go to Numbers, 13th chapter of Numbers, and this is a very familiar, good example. If you can't go on a prosperous journey, if a prosperous mind is not leading. 13th chapter of Numbers, many of us know this. This is part of the covenant of wealth for the children of God, that they were to go into Canaan after being delivered out of Egypt for those hundreds of years. The Lord delivers them. Amen. Then Moses tell them, listen, let me take 12 leaders from each tribe and go check out the land and come back and give us a report. Now, keep in mind, the land of promise, or Canaan, was the best of the land. So they went out and checked out the land. And let's pick it up in verse 25, 13th chapter of Numbers. And they returned from searching of the land after 40 days. And they went and came. 40 days they spent there now. See, it would have been different if they just a couple nights there. 40 days. And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran, to Kadesh, and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. It's important to have fruit. Now, I've said that for years. You know, we can faith talk all we want. That's fine. But after a while, where's the fruit? Can't keep telling me God is a healer and there's no fruit of healing after a while. Now, this is real. See, this is not no religion or nothing, you know? See, because we can get so caught up into becoming fans of what the word says. But where is the fruit? I'm not saying you have to show up tonight or tomorrow, but after a while. Where's the fruit? They brought back fruit to show, hey, the land is all that and some. Surely it floweth with silk and money. And this is the fruit of it. Because they came back with these big cluster grapes and say, listen, the land, listen, it is all that. You know, that'd be like you go somewhere and you come back and say, listen, see these diamonds and these pearls, this is what the fireplace is made out of. You see these blocks of solid gold, that's what's in the foyer. Some of y'all are like, for you? For you who? The foyer.
Amen. Go ahead.
Y'all still with me? I got to kind of nudge it on purpose, you know. Nevertheless, now this is where it gets uncomfortable in verse 28. Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great, and moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south. The Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains. And the Canaanites dwell by the sea. And we know that those represent certain spirits now. And by the coast of Jordan. Now, they weren't supposed to say all that. See, after they brought back the fruit and said, hey, it's all that what you said and some. First thing should have come out of their mouth, when we going? But now they're making all these excuses. So that's just like I bring back fruit, like I said. See, here's the gold. This is what's on the floor. Here's the pearls. This is what's on the fireplace. And then you come back and say, how much is the light bill?
Come on now. Amen. Amen.
You know, here's the new Mercedes. You seen this like this? Yeah, here's the fruit of it. Yeah. How much it cost to fill up? See, I know quite a few people who like staying in an apartment. I ain't coming against it. They don't want their own place because I don't want to be responsible. Something go wrong in that house, you got to be responsible. Duh. See, you'd be surprised where some folks at. You can give somebody something. Oh, I can't take that. That's too much for me. Invite them over to your house, put out nice dishes. You ain't got to do that for me. What a paper plate. I remember one time having a little gathering at my house, and I don't even remember who it was. It doesn't matter. But it was some, you know, it was disposable dishes. And the person asked, you need to save those. Why? I done lost some of y'all on that one. That's all right. I got my work cut out for me. That's all right. They look nice, but they disposable. They look like crystal, but they're not. They're plastic. So now, then verse 30, after they bring up all this, you know, Hittites there, verse 30 says, and Caleb steeled the people before Moses. In other words, he had to like, hey, shh. Sometimes all that negative stuff start coming in, you got to like, hey, let's get this stuff out of here. So he steeled the people before Moses and said, listen, let us go up at once and possess it, for we are well able to overcome it. But then the men that went up with him said, we be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. Now, keep in mind who went out to try out the land. These were not 12 guys, you know, who come to church every other month. These ain't the people who sleep in church. These were 12 leaders who were over people. You think if anybody gonna go and give the report, less than the top dogs, less than the honchos, less than the chiefs. There's a hidden message in that. You can have title leader, don't mean you won. So it said, we be not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. And they brought up an evil report of the land, which they had searched. Now, what made it an evil report? Because the land was wonderful. What made it an evil report? They were saying things they should not have said. They were not to come back and say that. God didn't tell them to say that. God didn't tell them to say the negativity about it. Sometimes you got to be careful. You know, God trying to do something good, and then somebody say, oh, you don't want, what you want to do that for? I heard them kind of cause, you know, if something happened to them, you can only take them to certain places, and it costs a lot. I had to talk to someone some time ago. They were about to buy something, and salesperson was almost trying to talk them out of it, trying to give this negative report about, you know, the particular car. And they don't listen to that. So they brought up an evil report in which the land the children of Israel saying, the land, though we were have gone to search it, it is a land that eateth up the inhabitants. Man, what are you getting this sound? This sound like cannibalism to me. Eat up the inhabitants. But the people eating the people? See, obviously some fear got in there. See, you can get so afraid. Now, you were talking about it was 10 guys that was there. It wasn't number two. 10 guys, they had a gun. No, they didn't. See, you, fear just gets you, I was going to say exaggerating, lying. And all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. Now, obviously, that wasn't true. Because if everybody there were giants, everybody, then they would have stood out like a sore thumb. Like, who y'all? Obviously, they were able to blend in for 40 days. See, just intimidation stuff. You know? Maybe the best of the land right now, maybe you don't see too many that look like you. But then you get scared. Huh? I remember years ago we were at some conference, I think it was Texas, I don't know, some years ago. Now I say these things because I've experienced them. Probably the first time there in a particular area, and you're kind of looking around. I ain't see nobody that looked like me. I was thinking like, and then after I finally seen somebody that looked like me in the restaurant, I got relieved. Ooh. Now see, that was wrong. That just showed that I had to clean that stuff up. See, and that's where some of us at. Certain areas you don't want to go in like, and all the people that we saw in that are men of great stature. Now, here's the worst part, too. And there we saw the giants. That's true. Giants were there. Giants is a good thing. Because it obviously meant the stuff there was big. I mean, they obviously were, I mean, I don't know if it's such thing as triple king-size beds, you know. I ain't slept in a twin bed since I lived with my mama when I was about 10 years old. That would be sinful for a grown 52-year-old man like me to get my body in a twin-size bed? What is this, jail? You talking about a sin? Somebody like, Pastor, don't go in my bedroom. I ain't. Twin beds for little kids. Grown folks ain't got no business. No, I know I'm making somebody choke. Good. Your set alarm going off. Good. Grown folks ain't got no business in no twin size bed. Yeah, I said it. Twin beds is for little kids. Real little kids. Now, some of you still got it. It's time to get them twin beds out. You shouldn't be in one and you got your teenagers in a twin side. Get that joke out. Ebobo Shondo, back to you. So there were giants in the land because the stuff was big. Big bathrooms. You know, it's more healthy physically when you can use a larger bathroom. I'm going to let your own imagination go with that. You stay healthier, you know. You can. It's hard to let go and let God when it's so tight. When it's big, you can have a revival. Y'all follow what I'm saying. So the giants were there because stuff was big. So we saw the giants, the son of Anak, which come of the giants. Now this is where that mindset was still off at. And we were in our own sight as grasshoppers. And so we were in their sight. Now keep in mind, these 12 leaders, it's nowhere in the world, they should have came up with that report. But see, once again, even though they were delivered out of Egypt, God brought them past the Red Sea and all of that. They're getting ready to go into Canaan. But that bondage mentality was still in them. Let alone we can't do this. We saw the giants there, and we were like just nobody, just like grasshoppers in their sight. See, in other words, and I said this in the first service, one of the manifestations of a person with low self-esteem and being insecure is what they think others think about them. When you think others think you're small, you're only exposing your low self-esteem. When you think others think they think they're better than you, you are the one who is insecure. When you think somebody think they look better than you, they don't have the problem. You do. Because it's about what they thought about them. That's when you have some folks who are paranoid. Nobody liked them. See, when they look, I know they don't like me. See, you got the problem. Your self-esteem is low. You're insecure. See, because when your self-esteem is high and you're secure, first of all, you think everybody loves you. And if they don't, you don't care. See, you don't think like, see, you think you more than me. See, you got the problem. Because you're thinking on what others think about you. So 12 leaders come back with a report. Caleb and Joshua, they had a different mindset. Their mindset was, let us go up at once and possess it. That was the right mindset because the land was theirs. Don't matter they had been in bondage those hundreds of years. The land was there. Why? Because of the promise that was made to Abraham. So they said, let's do it right now. That's how you feel. If you find out you got this land here, ain't no sense in me. Let me go get it now. You know how we are. That's how the reason some of us then got overextended in our credit. We didn't want to lay it away. We wanted it now. You saw it. You wanted to take it home today. Sometimes you lay it away too long, you don't want it anymore. Can I exchange this? So Joshua and Caleb had that mindset, we're well able to overcome it. But the other 10 leaders had a mindset of, we be not able to go up against the people. They're stronger than we. And Hebrews 3:13 says they couldn't enter in because of their unbelief. And we know in Joshua, they were supposed to have went in at that time because God had set the hearts of the Canaanites where they came in fear because they figured the people of God was getting ready to come in and possess the land. Because that's when Rahab, years later, when Joshua come in, Rahab said, listen, we had waited for you all 40 years ago. Y'all never showed up. Those big giants, everybody afraid. We getting ready to get taken over. Luckily, when they come, maybe they'll make us their slaves. But they never showed up because of their mindset. Some of us never show up because of our mindset. With a lot of things, it ain't as if God is withholding it back. It's you. Oh, my. So now, what is stopping your prosperous journey? You got to ask yourself that. Or to some, how come you're not on the journey of prosperity? Why? Because your mind can't lead you to where it's not. Now, we can get our mouth to say anything. We can say we want this. But is your mind there? You know, is your mind set there? I've seen people get married. They want to get married, and sometimes they get married, but their mind was never there, and they can't finish it out. I want kids. Because if your mind was never there, you get these kids, now you can't deal with them. Now somebody else got to raise your kids. So we could all say we want the prosperous journey. But if your mind is not there, it's not going to happen. You know, we say, hey, I want to be healed. Well, is your mind set there? Or do you still believe, you know, these certain diseases and sicknesses run in our family? So-and-so-so got it at 50. Uncle Bubba got it at 40. So-and-so-so got it. And it looks like I'm going to get it. But you're saying with your mouth, I want to be healed. I want to be healthy. Well, we say again, well, you know, the older you get, stuff start breaking down. Your mind can't lead you to where it's not. Now, if that's the case, if it's on me, then let's stop the religious thing. Stop blaming the devil for everything. Devil is not the problem. He's not the holdup. Don't blame your lack of prosperity on your job. I'm not prosperous because I only make $5 an hour. That's not true. Because remember, we prosper and be in health according to what? Your sole not what you get paid on your job, not what comes in the check in the mail once a month, not none of that. It's according to your soul, your mindset. See, long as you keep making other things that, then you're going to forever be restricted, and you'll never walk in that journey of prosperity, because my prosperity is based on my paycheck. And truth be told, most of us can't even say that, because most paychecks ain't all that much, if we be honest about it. Now, I know some of us feel better when you get paid. But not with everybody, but most folks, most of them checks are already spent. You just do other stuff. Most people, to pay all your bills up to date, your check ain't covering it. Not if they paid you 3 months in advance. It still won't cover it. I didn't say with everybody. Truth be told. See, because what can happen with that, we can get so settled with being late. It's just like in your car. You know your car, when it's on E, you know kind of, especially if you've had it a while, you know how far it can go to E before you put some in it. And we do that with our life with bills. You know what you can pay up to a point before they cut it off? And it's okay, I deal with the penalty if the rent is behind or the mortgage or whatever it is. We're used to doing that. We used to buy stuff by check. Then the next day or 2 days, run to that bank. So now, oh gosh, let me hurry. Even though your soul leads, but who's in charge of what your mind feeds on? You. You're in control. You're in control of what you hear, what you say, everything. You're in control of what you allow to get in your mind. You're in control. You don't have to look at everything and listen to everything. You don't have to be around certain people. You don't have to. You're in control. Your soul leads, but you're in charge of what your mind feeds on. For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. So whatever you continuously think in the mind of your heart, your life is going to follow. Because you're going to always move in the direction of what you think about the most. That's why I used to tell people, when people say, oh, I just slipped in sin. There's no such thing as that. Because the scriptures say that seed is first conceived in the heart. It's in the mind. It begins there. I say, I don't know how it just happened. I didn't mean to sleep with them. What do you mean? We was just talking. That is one of the most neat, that's a neat Las Vegas trick. Talking to sleeping together. What a magical moment. You could just, all of a sudden talking, then all of a sudden slept together. What a trick. You can take that on the road. Slept together because you thought about it. Now, see, some of y'all, I feel some of you, no, it wasn't. Well, if you were not, nobody forced you, yes, you did. I don't know how I smoked that joint. Once again, that's a neat trick. But to just all of a sudden get in your hand. Now, I know because before I got saved, I used to smoke reefer. There's a certain way you grab it. So there's no, it just all of a sudden, there's a certain way you grab it. In the late 70s, guys, we had nails. It was cool to have nails then. Now, I don't know. You know. No accidents. It's in that mind. For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he, so he become. You'll always move in the direction of what you think about the most. What is it that dominates your thoughts? So now, if I want to get on this prosperous journey, my mind has got to become prosperous. And I've got to start at the top, my head. Got to start it here. And what I found out, and you don't have to turn to it, but in the math, in ninth chapter of Matthew, verse 16 and 17, it talks about you don't put new wine into old bottles. And I use that scripture because you have a lot of Christians who are, they're frustrated. You know, we read all of these promises and all of these things, but the problem is you can't have a prosperous and a poverty mindset at the same time. See, we're trying to put the new wine into the old bottle. You can't do both. You're confusing your mind. See, you hear all this on Sunday, but then your mind's saying something else tonight. You know how it is we can do? That's why we have to always be careful of I like to call them pep rallies. And I'm all for praising and thank God. You know him. That's wonderful. But you got to be careful that you don't just get caught up into the pep rally. Because I always say pep rallies don't win games. You could have great pep rallies, but then they get on the field and play and lose. Amen. You can be here excited, shouting this or that, but then when the game of life comes, you lose. Yeah. So you can't confuse your mind. Yeah. And most Christians are frustrated because they're trying to play both sides. Yeah. Your soul, your mind is confused. It's not committed. We saying money cometh, but it's not committed. See, we can say those words, I'm wealthy, I'm rich, I'm prosperous, I'm successful, but we're not committed. We want the million-dollar lifestyle. But you still got food stamps running that mindset. You want the prosperous life. But you can't imagine letting go of the Section 8. I ain't coming against it. What do I always say? You may start that way, but you don't have to end your life on that. I'm serious. Some folks are real. That mindset is there. Somebody say, you know what? I give you a house of this debt. And somebody might say, well, if I do get this, would it mess with my Section 8? Would it mess with my check? That's another message for another time. I ain't saying folks ain't saved, but, you know, lying is lying. That mindset. See, your soul can't lead you to the prosperous journey if you're still committed to government programs. I ain't saying it's wrong. Don't misunderstand. Now, either you want this or you don't. Now, let me say this too, so somebody goes too far to the left. I'm not telling anybody to go get off some and go, no, if your mindset ain't there, don't you do nothing. Now, I'm trying to tell you to get your mindset there. Because I ain't telling no. See, the pastor, see, you can get this pep rally. That's right. I'm going to call them tomorrow. I don't want the link card no more. Take this Section 8. I don't want nothing. Just give me the regular bill. See, now you's all pumped up now. Then your $27 you was paying every month. Now they say, oh, you want it all? Okay, $1,800 a month now. Medical card, no problem. We'll go back. Remember when you was in the hospital? Remember them doctor visits? Now you owe us $11,476.23. So I ain't telling anybody. But you don't have to stay there. See, you see, if you want this, you're going to have to change that mindset. Now, how do we do this? And I'm going to end it. Let's go to Romans 12 and 2. How do I get on this prosperous journey? Romans 12 and 2. Man, I stayed long on some other. I don't know. Oh, gosh. Oh, man. Oh. 12th chapter of Romans, verse 2. It says, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now, I know we've read this verse, we've heard this verse for years, but it's really a specific instruction. In order for the will of God to manifest in my life, I've got to stop the worldly way of thinking by getting transformed. But the transformation can only take place when the mind is renewed. And the word renewed means to renovate. It means to gut out. I like to give the example, if we were to renovate this room or gut it out, we would more or less take everything out other than the shell. To gut this room out, just gut it out. You wouldn't see no drywall, nothing. It's just gut it out. You just see the brick, the shell of it. In other words, it means to renovate the mind, renew the mind, to remove all thought patterns that's contrary to where you want to go and how you want to go. So now if I'm trying to get on this prosperous journey, if I'm trying to put my mind that way, then I'm going to have to get all that stuff out. I can't feed it any longer with that other stuff that's contrary to the prosperous journey. So all thought patterns that doesn't line up to where I'm trying to go and even how I want to go. Now, that's key too, how I want to go. Because you want the prosperous journey based on the world, on the word. See, you ain't trying to get prosperous any kind of way. So it's important on where I go, but how I go. I want to do this God's way, not my way. See, you keep trying to do stuff your way. And we all know that. I've been there. You try stuff your way, and then it seemed like you're getting ahead, then all of a sudden the rug pulled up on you. Because you keep trying to do it your way. And as long as you keep trying to do it your way, now definitely, the devil ain't going to let you get far. Because he's the little G-O-D of this system. In other words, he'll change the rules. I've been saying that for the last 12 years. You know, people always get caught into, well, you know, they say I can get the car if my credit score is whatever. And I ain't coming against all of that. But see, if that's your only way, the enemy will make sure that you struggle with that. You know, while they tell you this time, get it up here. The enemy said, okay. See, because he know your heart. See, he know you're going to stay safe. He know you love God. He know you'll be a better Christian when you move to the other side. He know this. So if you stuck on the world's way, he will make sure you never get it because he'll change the rules on you. See, they'll tell you, you know, okay, get your credit to 650 and then pay off a few bills. Now, you done borrowed money and paid off them bills and come back. Man, I'm a credit 6. And they say, you know, things change now. Now you need 700. Man, I didn't spent a year trying to get 6. He's the God of this system. He controls how this stuff operates. He is. God is not in control of that. The enemy is the God of this system. That's why we have something that supersedes the system. Now, let me say this once again, so if somebody take it to the left. I'm not telling nobody, see, forget my credit. I ain't thinking about my credit. That's why I ain't going to pay my bill. No, don't you do that. Because some people do that. Well, the pastor said, hey, you know, it ain't about my credit, so it don't matter. I ain't got to pay my bills. No, that's not what I said. So now, how do I stop being conformed? Conforming, shaped, or molded to the world's way of thinking? I've got to change my programming. Oh, gosh, can I get about 5 minutes? I've got to change my programming. See, what I'm teaching now, this is some things that's missing. Most of you love God. I know you do. I'm not saying you're perfect and all of that, but, hey, you on the right track. You, and it's like, okay, Lord, what's going on here? And a lot of it, it's here. You want to go there, but this is not allowing you because this leads you. You want to go. You want it. You really do. But this is what leads you there. And in order for me to get there, this has got to be there. So now, I got to stop being conformed to the world's way by changing my program. You see, the way you're living right now is only a reflection of how you've been living on the inside. Your thoughts. What is it that you be thinking about throughout the day? You know, whether you're at work, at home, what really dominates your thoughts? See, when you kind of locate that, then you kind of sense kind of why I'm somewhat in the position I'm in. See, if your thoughts are, man, I got to pay these bills. Now you wonder why the position you're in. And that's with anything. See, remember, thoughts are things. And those things in your thoughts, they are control the direction of your life. Now, how does this all work? See, all of us, we're designed to respond to whatever programming has been set in us. We all have a program in us. All of us. We've been programmed over years. In other words, how you perceive things, how you take information in, how you comprehend things, you know, how you react to certain things is based on a program. You know, there's a certain programming in all of us if somebody call you out your name. Some may have it under control, call me out of my name, and you don't say anything. But the others call you out of your name, you're going to respond. Because there's a programming in all of us. When we see certain things, when we hear certain things, we get the same response. You know, whatever's been programmed in. If it's been programmed in you that every time you get a headache, you look for an aspirin or medicine or something, next time you get a headache, that's what you're going to do because you're programmed. I remember it took me probably at least a year, when we would leave church, because I stayed where I stayed at for 20 years, and it took me really almost a year to really, because I was so programmed to leave here and drive east, because I lived there for 20 years, and then once I moved far west, it took me a while to adjust my system because I was just so used to, and I'd get at the stoplight and my mind would just freeze for a second because I was so programmed of going back east. See, we all have a set programming in us. Certain things happen, we respond the same way. You know, that's just the same. If you don't change that mindset with prosperity, somebody can give you stuff and you'll still respond. You know, you can have $50 million. And then somebody say, you know, oh, let's go on a trip to Hawaii. You'd be like, oh, how much that cost? See, because you're so programmed. You can afford to go now. But see, if that program has changed, you still. You know. So all of us have a specific program. See, whatever you've been programmed to do is what you're going to automatically do. Why? Because you can't separate your reactions from your already planned actions. I know this is sounding so, but it's so important that you get this. There's no separation from your believing system and your actions. See, whatever what's been programmed in, you're going to respond that way. Even if you really don't want to, you can't help it. That's why when some folks, something happened to them and then they cuss and they say, oops, but they always do that. It's not oops, that's what's in them. There's no oops. If it wasn't in you, it wouldn't have came out. You know, when some folks, when they can really, really cuss, that ain't the first time you cuss. That stuff is in you. I mean, some folks can like, I mean, my God, they say some words like, I didn't know that was a cuss word. Because that's what's in them. Person could just cuss you up. I didn't mean to say that. Yes, you did. Now, let me end. And I said this years and years ago. We know that there are three compartments within your mind that really contributes to your believing system. So now if I want to get on this journey of prosperity, I'm going to have to change that believing system. And the three compartments to that mindset is the conscious, the conscious, and the subconscious. Very, very important. The conscience is really that what we call that value system that picks up values and morals. In other words, your parents teach you right from wrong. And then if you violate that, then your conscience bothers you. Amen. You know, I shouldn't have did that. You know, because it's a value system. It makes you uneasy. When it's like when you know you did something you shouldn't have. I'm not talking from a spiritual standpoint. You're like, I shouldn't have did. It bothers your conscience. Now, the conscience, C-O-N-C-S-C-I-O-U-S, that's the purpose function that really makes everyday decisions. In other words, it's like a mental awareness. It's like you know where you're at right now. You know you're at church. You know you're not at work. Well, to me, you know you're not at home. You know you're not at the grocery store. You're consciously aware that you're in church. The conscious mind, it knows yourself in a certain environment. You're consciously aware of when you're in a certain environment. I know I'm at a party. I know I'm at the store. It's total awareness. You are consciously aware of it. Now, then there's the subconscious. And the subconscious is that part of you that it really will function without your conscious perception. In other words, it functions really deep. That's that part for as a man thinketh, and it functions deep. The subconscious operates without you consciously knowing it. It's kind of like autopilot. It functions without any effort. You know, it's just like subconscious works like this. You know, you ever dreamt something, then you wake up like, man, where did that come from? You even dreamt about something crazy and you weren't even thinking about that. Not consciously. I'm the only one that's ever had to. I have dreams like, man, where'd that come from? See, because the subconscious doesn't need the permission of your conscious. It's automatic. You know, it's like you would have nightmares. See, the mind is so strong. You ever had a nightmare and you wake up and you out of breath? As if this really, really happened. But the thing is, it happened here. It didn't physically happen. You didn't even leave the bed. You sweating, waking up. Ooh, yeah. You ain't even left the bed. But the mind doesn't know the difference. In your mind, this happened. In your mind, you was running from that dog. To your mind, these things happened. That's the subconscious. Now, the programming of the subconscious is what affects your believing system. So what I've got to do, are you all still here and I ain't lost y'all? Some of y'all feel like I'm in school. Well, I guess you are. See, you get some of this from the church, you don't have to be looking at some of that other stuff. Mm-hmm. Dr. So-and-so saying on TV, no, you ain't got to do all that. Programming of the subconscious is what affects your believing system. See, what you've got to do, you've got to get the word in that subconscious. The promises of God, they have to go beyond that conscious mindset, which is what's happening now, because you are consciously aware of what you're reading and what I'm telling you. But I've got to get that in my subconscious. Yes. See, because if I get it in my subconscious, then what's there is going to stay there. It's going to change my believing system. It's going to change my reactions. In other words, when it gets in my subconscious, if something comes up, it's going to automatically come out. See, in other words, if I change that subconscious, and if I get a headache, now I've changed it to where I go to the word. When a headache comes, I'm not going to the medicine cabinet. I go to the word because it's in the subconscious now. Just like I changed my subconscious, I changed my believing system. When I leave here now, there's no way I'm going east. I'm automatically going west. Because it had to get changed in here. See, if you don't change it really deep within, you could want these things and you'll try to get on that journey. But you know what happened? It's like there's a set point in us and a rubber band. It'll just snatch you back. See, if you don't change your beliefs, when I talk to people sometimes, they say, Pastor, I want to come to church every Sunday. I believe you do. You really do. But you got to change it in here. See, until you change that in here, you will try and you really want to. And you have every intention of doing it. But you know what? That set point is like a rubber band. It'll bring you right back. And you won't be able to do it until you change that inside. It's subconscious where that's just what you do now. On Sunday, I ain't doing nothing else. I'm going to church. And that works with anything, whether it's giving. You know, see, you see, if it's not changed, you'll try it. You'll do it because you want to and you know it's right. But if it's not changed on the inside, you'll get pulled back just like that. And it's the same thing with this journey of prosperity. You want it. I know you do. But if you don't change that mindset, then you're not going to be able to go there. See, now I know this sounds like all psychological babble, but no, it's not. This is biblical. That's even what part of meditation. It is still a spiritual experience, but you've got to change in here. Because once you change in here, then it's going to affect what's happening on the outside. You know when you need some change and you go into a store and you look at something and say, man, this is nice. Then you look at the price tag and choke. Man, I got to change that. And I can't get to that prosperous journey if I'm still choking over a $1,200 dress. You know you like it. Forget it. I'm going to wait till it go on sale. Some things don't go on sale. Now, some people think that. There are some things don't go on sale. That's just that's what they cost. I can't walk in the Bentley deal and say, hey, bro, can you give me a deal on this Bentley? They look at me like, they don't go on sale. Whatever the price is, that's what it is. Now, see, some of y'all don't know that because maybe your car got on sale. Certain stuff don't go on sale. I'm out of time. We're going to pick this whole covenant of wealth up next time. Come on, let's give God praise. Hallelujah.